Thank you very much for coming. I want you to join me in welcoming my three very distinguished authors, Hannah Rothschild, Simon Winchester, and Wilbur Smith. I'm going to try as much as possible to let them speak and for you to ask questions. There's only one rule. When you ask a question, please make sure that it's intelligent. this is an intelligent forum, and don't ask tedious questions like, what inspires you to write? That sort of question will be passed over, and you'll be thrown out. I am so delighted that I brought three extraordinary authors and of such diversity. As you all probably know, Wilbur Smith has been writing for the best part of 40 or 50 years, and he's published over 40 books, have sold, I think, about 150 million copies, and is still going strong. And I just brought out The Predator this year, which has gone straight to number one in the US and in the UK. Nobody really knows how he does it. People don't even think he exists, but I'm very glad to say that we have a very robust Wilbur Smith here today, who will also answer all your questions. Simon Winchester is also an extraordinary writer who has written many books. I reminded him that he has written one novel about Hong Kong, which was all wrong, but he has concentrated on other books, on biographies and extraordinary subjects. But his career has not only been writing books, but as a journalist, and a very distinguished one, who has covered Ireland and many other places, including having lived in Hong Kong for a while. And lastly, but not least of which, Hannah Rothschild, who has come to writing, or publishing rather, rather late in life, if I may say that. Not as young as when Simon Winchester nor Wilbur Smith started their writing, but at a mature age, which is just right for bringing out a perfect or near-perfect masterpiece, which was an biography of a relation of hers. And then last year, a wonderful novel, and I particularly want her to bring her to Hong Kong because she would inspire those of us who have been harboring this ambition to write books and never getting round to it, not to despair until at least the age of 40, which is, of course, the age when Hannah started writing, or even 41 or 42. Anyway, I don't want to intrude on their what they want to say, and I'm simply going to have a very gentle conversation with each of our authors, and then I'm going to let you, the audience, ask all the questions. So if you might bear with us for about 5 or 10 minutes so that they can also say what they particularly like to say, to give you some background, and you can then choose to ask questions which are best addressed to the panel, all three of them, rather than singly. But of course, there might be questions which are only meant for Simon or Wilbur or Hannah, because if it is about anybody who lived 2,000 years ago, that's got to be Wilbur. Not because of his age, by the way, because that's the kind of fictional character he writes. Now, Wilbur, you had a father who you said never read a book in his life and certainly hasn't read one of yours, and he was a man's man. He was a very strong man. He was brought up working with his hands, and he was a boxer, and he was a hunter, And he actually had a cattle ranch, which you worked on, and at no time did he want you to be a writer. And indeed, you listened to him a bit, and you became an accountant. And you then worked for the Inland Revenue. I mean, I can't think of anything more tedious or boring than that. And thank God you managed to turn into an author. What actually turned you from an accountant into an author and a very successful one?
Well, I was never an accountant.
Really?
I was always an author lurking in the shadows pretending to be an accountant. And I thank my father for that because he said, what are you going to do with your life? I said, I'm going to write books. He said, don't be stupid. You'll starve to death. Go and get a real job. So that's what I ended up camouflage my real job by pretending to be an accountant. And I picked out a very lucky place to start because I was in the income tax department and they put me in charge of the deceased accounts, those dead people and their money. And I had three ladies working under me. They were all 50 years older than me, and they'd all been in the job for 30 years, and I had not been a year in the job. So I said, ladies, I expect you to just get on with it and don't give me a hard time. And I used the income tax hours to begin writing my first novel. Then, having published the first novel, which was a masterpiece. It really was. It was about 2,000 pages long. It was me, and it was all the thoughts of me, my great imaginings. And unfortunately, it was rejected by 30 different publishers. So I went back to my accounts department, and I gave up. And then the lady who'd offered to be my agent wrote to me after 2 years of not producing anything and said, when are you writing your next book? My first feeling was to say to her, never. But she said, there was a lot of good stuff in your first attempt. Now let's get on with it, one. So I said, okay. And I wrote When the Lion Feeds. I sent it over to London from Africa, and within 2 weeks, it had been accepted by Heinemann, by a man who was later to become one of my closest friends and advisors in writing and the art of storytelling. And from then on, I've been totally unemployed. So
That was Charles...
Charles Pick.
Charles Pick, yes. Yeah.
And I have lived most of the time in Africa, but for the first time, after I'd published the first book, I went to the UK. And since then, I have been footloose and fancy free. And I've written 40 books. I've got another couple under my belt. And with the help of my darling wife. And so that is my story.
Well, we're going to... the audience is going to quiz you a bit more later, but this Charles Pick that had become your agent and your friend, he gave you some very specific advice, didn't he, that you kept to a T, like only write about things that you know about.
Correct. Only write about things you know about, and don't take any notice of what people tell you.
And then he said something even stronger. He says, until it's written, a book is merely smoke in the wind, and it can be blown away by a careless word. So you just get on with it.
That's exactly right. Don't go to people and say, what do you think of the story? Because they'll say, oh, God, please. It's been done. Shakespeare did it. And so that is the thing. You hold your book as a secret to yourself until it's published.
Well, I'm sure you have a lot more secrets to impart in a minute. Now, Simon Winchester, I've known you many years. You lived in Hong Kong. You started off as a journalist, and I knew about you when you were writing for The Guardian, when you wrote about the Irish situation, and you wrote about Hong Kong extensively. You didn't start off being an author. You actually read geology at university. But then you read one book which absolutely changed and made up your mind to become an author. Tell us about your traumatic experience in switching.
It wasn't really traumatic. It was a Pauline conversion or a Damascene conversion.
All right, okay.
And oddly enough, it was also...
Get on with it.
...in Africa. I will. I'm just holding on a second. I'm being paid by the word here, I thought. I was not a good geologist. I got a very poor degree and got a job in Uganda working for a Canadian mining company looking for copper and living in a little village called Kayanjojo on the Congolese-Ugandan border. And I was very interested in climbing, mountain climbing, and there was a library run by the British Council, maybe 30 miles away from the tented encampment that I was living in. And I used to get books about climbing, and one day I got a book almost at random called Coronation Everest by a man called James Morris. And I took it back to my tent and read it, and it was the story. James Morris was the London Times correspondent assigned in 1953 to the Mount Everest expedition, which got to the summit on the 31st of May, 1953. And James told the story. He had never climbed in his life before, but he got up to 26,000 feet. And he also, through a very elaborate system of codes, managed to get the news of the success, if you remember it was Hillary and Tensing who finally got to the summit, back to London in time for it to be published in the Times on the 2nd of June, 1953, which was the date of the Queen's coronation. So I remember I was 8 years old at the time and remember seeing not only we were all very happy having a new young queen crowned, but also that a British expedition, the last sort of imperial hurrah, if you like, got to the summit of the world's highest mountain. I was completely enraptured by this book because I basically wanted to travel around the world on someone else's dime, and I had tried to join the Royal Navy but couldn't because it turned out I was red-green colorblind. And then thought a geological career might do the trick, but I just wasn't terribly good at it. And then suddenly I read this book, and I thought, if I just pick up, as James had done, a notebook and a pencil, maybe someone will employ me to go around the world as a journalist. So I sat down and wrote a letter in my tent to James Morris, care of his publishers, Faber and Faber, 3 Queen Square, London, WC2, England, saying, dear Mr. Morris...
No postal code then?
No, but they had WC2. No, it wasn't WC2XN37, or whatever it is now. And so, dear Mr. Morris, I'm a 21-year-old geologist living in East Africa, and I've just read your book, Coronation Everest, and can I be you, basically? And you'd think that he would ignore the letter completely, but he didn't, and 2 weeks later, I got a letter in the mail, and I remember Dove Grey Stationery with red embossed his address in North Wales, in a village called Llany Stumdwy, where Lloyd George was born, oddly enough, saying, dear Mr. Winchester, I'm so glad you enjoyed my book. And if you want to be a writer, you'll never earn much money, but you'll have an extraordinarily interesting life, and it is a wonderful way to earn a modest living. So my advice to you is very simple. On the day you receive this letter, not next week, not next month, but the day you receive it, resign from your company in East Africa, go to Entebbe Airport and fly back to London and get a job on a local newspaper and write to me again. And I decided, what the heck? And my employers, who were at this Canadian mining company, could not have been more happy. Can we give you a limousine, please? You have found no copper in the year you've been here. So here's a car, take you straight back to Entebbe, get on the BOAC flight to London. Well, there's a part two to this story, which I won't, because I don't want to take up Hannah's time, which is unutterably bizarre, and I'll tell you that in a moment, perhaps.
Not about the...
No. Don't spoil it.
but gives anyway, it away a bit when you say, I want it to be you.
Well, exactly. That's
all right, okay. Well, I'll leave that to you on tantalizing second half, about which I know. And it is very funny. Now, Hannah Rothschild, you are Rothschild, and you never really intended to be a writer. You've been a philanthropist. You've spent a great deal of time not only looking after great treasures of Britain, but also a great number of people and enabling them to enjoy the works of art that you are passionate about. And you've been a documentary filmmaker and so forth. And it wasn't until about, you know, much later that you decided to publish a book. And then it was a biography about a relation of yours. And then you obviously suddenly got rather familiar with the act of writing, and you wanted to do more, and you last year published your first novel, and I'm sure that you'll go on now writing a few more. Tell us about your seemingly reluctant journey to write and publish until much later in life than one might otherwise expect.
Thank you, David. I must say, I think if you think I'm the oldest person on the panel, of course you're right. I've got a very, very good surgeon. or maybe you don't think I have got a very good surgeon. But anyway, I did harbour secret desires to be a writer, but I didn't have the confidence. So I was born, as David said, into this, you know, rather illustrious family. And one thing that was absolutely clear is that no female Rothschilds were allowed to work in the family business. And that was a rule that had been started by the first Rothschild, Mayor Amschel, and held true until very recently. So women were allowed principally to be mothers and wives and occasionally to be bookkeepers. Well, I knew that I wasn't any good as a bookkeeper, and then I thought, what else could I do? And then some of my family were scientists, and I was absolutely hopeless as a scientist. And then they made wine, and I'm afraid I haven't got the magic nose to do that. So I did what other people in England, when they don't know what to do, did, and I went to work for the BBC, which has been absolutely true. It's one of the great kind of, you know, employment centres for many generations of people. So I used to write a little bit through that, but really what documentary filmmaking, which was the department I got into, only because no other department would have me. Again, true story. So I went into documentaries and I started making films, and it was a form of storytelling. But I said a little bit earlier, it's quite limited because, although I love documentaries, you are limited by what you see and what you hear. And I always felt maybe that there was something more. In the course of that, I met a relation, my great aunt, who's the subject of my first book, who had run away from her kind of very, very kind of strict and limited childhood. She was known as Nika Rothschild because she heard a jazz record by Thelonious Monk. So she got on a plane and she went to New York, whereupon she was never, ever, ever spoken about, quite understandably, because she lived with black men and she flew Lancaster bombers and she took drugs and she stayed up all night. So she was literally airbrushed out. But of course, I wanted to meet her. So I went to New York and rang her up and I said, I'm your great niece. And she went, wild. And I was hooked, and I saw then, she gave me the courage to believe I could do something different. So I made a film about her, and I kept hearing this wild in the background. And one day, I'm going to go further than this. I'm going to write her biography. And David's absolutely right. It lit the touch paper in a way. And having done the biography, I thought novels, which is, you know, my secret long, long held desire. And then I wrote this novel, which is set in the art world, and it's full of all the scurrilous people I've ever met. I won't say whether David's in there or not, but you can read it and find out. So that's my journey so far.
Well, very good. Well, anyway, I'm sure that most of you have read some of the books that the authors here. So without further ado, let's start the session, because these sessions are not supposed to be monologues. They're supposed to be a dialogue. So let's have a question. Who can ask an intelligent question? Right, I think that's the end of the forum. Sorry, okay, yeah, the girl at the back. Oh, sorry, man at the back. We can never see because of these terrible lights. Every year I ask them not to light us only, but to light you as well. But they never listen. But then, you know, it's Hong Kong government. What do you expect?
Well, thank you, David. I consider that
they might do it after 15 years. Sorry.
That's fine. Thanks, David. I consider that a compliment. So, yeah. I've just this one particular question to ask Miss Rothschild, because obviously you're born into one of the, if not the most important family on the planet right now. When you announced that you wanted to write a novel or something, when you started your writing career, did people take you seriously, or was it, how easy or difficult was it for people to take you seriously?
I think in a way the first person, I mean, I found it very difficult to take myself seriously. I don't know why you're laughing, it's absolutely true. I kind of thought, who am I to have something to say? Who am I to do that? And I was absolutely amazed then when an agent took me seriously and then a publisher took me seriously. And I didn't show it to anybody in my family because I thought that they wouldn't take it very seriously. The book came out, and again, I didn't have any idea at all about whether it would be taken seriously. And then I got nominated for one prize, and then two prizes, and then three prizes. And I'm not saying prizes are everything, but I think the honest, truthful answer to your question is I'm just beginning to take myself seriously as a writer. I don't know whether anyone else has the same...
Have already told a story of how your first... a huge effort was turned down and wasn't taken very seriously, but you then got on. But was it always a smooth ride? I mean, did you, in your 50 year of career, had people constantly coming up to you expressing skepticism and telling you that you're not really serious about that, or you shouldn't be taken seriously?
Well, I think I had the best ride in the game park. I just caught everything right. I got a Charles Pick, who became my advisor and who's the head of the publishing company that took me under their wing. And he, until his death, fairly recently, he guided me all the way. And I'd say to him things like, "Now what do I write?" And he'd say to me, "Wilbur, you're going to write what you feel is time to write, not listen to another person." And that has been my...
guiding principle.
Yeah, my motto was to do what I want to do and not to listen.
No, but when you finished a particular book, even though you were becoming famous and infamous, did people say, "That wasn't very good, Wilbur, can you try again?"
Well, there are a lot of stupid people in the world. And I have met a few of them.
Yes. Ask J.K. Rowling. Yes. And you have met a few of them. Can you write down their names so that we can avoid them? Simon, I mean, were you at any time being questioned about your being serious?
Well, I was just thinking of Nightmare Stories, the third book I wrote. And before 1998, none of my books did any business at all, but the third book was about the British aristocracy. And I, as you probably know, the dukes, marquesses, viscounts, earls, barons, I interviewed dozens and dozens of them and wrote a book arguing effectively, because I worked for The Guardian, that they should all be abolished immediately, which didn't exactly endear.
The hereditary ones.
Hereditary ones, yes. Yeah. And... not exactly, you're okay. And one of them sued me. And the weird thing had happened. This particular chap, who was the sixth earl, he was a Scottish earl, and was a hang'em and flog'em, very right-wing sort of chap. He, during the process of publication, died, and the earldom was assumed by his son, who was the exact opposite of his father. He was a liberal, he couldn't have been a nicer, gentler fellow. But my book didn't say the sixth Earl believed such and such. It said the Earl believed such and such, and he immediately said, well, he's writing about me, when he knew full well I wasn't. Anyway, he sued, and we, first of all, tribes living in New York at the time, we tried to put an erratum slip in, but no, he wouldn't accept that. He actually got an injunction. All the books that were published had to be withdrawn.
But what did you say about him, first of all?
I said that he was a hang'em and flog'em right-wing nutcase.
Right,
and he wasn't,
not his much.
Father was. But anyway, so it was a successful action. I had to, and unfortunately, the small print of my contract, and I was at the time 30, something like that, said that I had to indemnify the publishers against any losses. So both Faber and Faber in London and my American publishers, who were Harper and Row, now HarperCollins, who are still my publishers, said, we still want to publish the book, so we're going to pulp the existing ones and reprint it, and you have to pay the money, which I think was $150,000, which is a 30-year-old journalist working for The Guardian.
So where do you get the money from?
That's another story.
No, tell us, how did you get the money?
Well, I did. There was an installment plan, I think. worked out. But it was a sobering experience to get it right.
Well, let's have another question. Yes, the lady, the blonde hair, yes. Those of you who are holding the microphone, you're supposed to look for the people, not...
Right.
Hi. Right. 你看着人,你举手就给他就行了。
Okay, thank you, Sir David. Hannah, your book on the Baroness was endearing, and it was also frightening in some ways. Frightening in the sense of some of the stories that you exposed on the family, endearing on some of the stories like with Miriam and the little mice running on the table and when you spent the night and so on. Did you get resistance from the family printing the book?
Yes, I got a huge resistance. So what happened was that great aunt Nika had five children, and the five children, although she never abandoned them, she did choose to live away from them. So she left them with their father, and she went to live with Felonious Monk and his friends in New York. And those five children were very, very, very keen that nobody should write about their mother for quite complicated reasons. I think partly, in a way, she'd sucked up too much oxygen already during their childhood, and partly because they felt protective towards her. They didn't want the wrong stories to come out. And then the other members of my family, you know, she was a black sheep. She didn't quite kind of portray what, you know, the way they wanted to be seen. And lastly, I wrote very openly for the first time about mental illness, which is something that my family, like many other families, sadly, you know, has gone through and is afflicted by. And I felt that it was quite important, actually, to write about this, because it did scar many generations of our lives. And so I remember saying to my father, for example, who's somebody I work with, you know, I absolutely adore, who I respect, and I said, you know, I want to do this. And he took a very, very deep breath, and he said, well, if you feel you really have to, then I will stand by you. And I said, I think I really do have to. And then he never mentioned another word. And actually, since it's been published, lots of the younger generation have said, thank goodness you brought this out in the open. Thank you for actually, you know, opening the windows and talking about this thing that had never been talked about. In our case, it was schizophrenia. So that was the... And I think now... Now people in the family actually quite like it, and I hear them, you know, mention it, and I hear it's kind of referred to. But, you know, we're not the kind of people who would go jolly good. You know, it's not our style, really. But it just kind of creeps out gradually. So that was my experience.
But glad you
liked it. Thank you.
Yeah. You wrote a lot. Most of your characters are fictional, and you make them up. But surely there must have been lurking similarities to people you know or within your family and so forth. Did you have problem with members of a family or friends coming after you published a book, and start questioning why you have written about them in the way you had?
No, not at all. In fact, they all try to claim to be the heroes of all my
No villains.
Are quite attractive people. Yeah. They're strong and yeah. they win in the end, and everyone wants to be like that.
Yes. And Simon, other than after this defamation, you must have been much more careful. Any further contretemps with other people who accused you of writing all sorts of things?
Don't think so. I mean, you, of course, always claim I got it wrong. But generally speaking...
No, but I mean, as a journalist, I remember you got something terribly wrong with Cathay Pacific.
Oh, don't go into that, for God's sake. It is true, do not.
It's a family forum, so we won't.
But there was a case where I was condemned in Parliament, and I mean, that kind of thing is...
This was the Bloody Sunday business.
I had been at Bloody Sunday when... those 14 people were shot dead in January 1971, and I saw them being shot dead, and I
What date?
30th of January, Sunday.
What time?
About 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
All right. Be more precise next time.
4:05.
I
don't know who you were.
Your name in Parliament.
Yeah, I was named in Parliament and condemned, and then there was an official inquiry, and all my evidence was rubbished. And then Tony Blair set up the Savile inquiry 40 years later, and I was one of the 900 witnesses, and finally the truth came out. And
sort
I had
of Hillsborough.
No, it wasn't Hillsborough. That was a football stadium.
No, equivalent in taking so long.
Yes.
For God's sake, use your mind ahead. Okay, next question. You're going to need to wake him up. Right. Okay, the Chinese lady, yeah.
About publishers and the way that...
Use the microphone.
Microphone.
It's in front of you. Hello.
Sorry, I apologize. This is a question for publishers. I think that most writers are struggling, poor, and work very hard to get the book ready. But I think when anyone approaches a publisher, they always get rejections. They don't get any acknowledgements nowadays. And basically, the scene really is very, very dismal for writers to be. I'm an independently published writer myself, but and that really taught me a lot about publishers. I believe that, you know, apart from Simon, who's got some political viewpoints, perhaps, unless, you know, you have contacts, agents are very established in your family, it's quite rare, really, to be accepted, to have your book accepted by a publisher.
But you can now publish yourself, can't you? I mean, you can publish yourself at limited cost on the internet. And I think there's obviously another question. Is your book good enough? I mean, usually.
Well, I think it is finally, but I didn't approach it.
So you've written a book and you've been rejected. How many times?
A couple of times.
Well,
I didn't. I didn't approach.
Wilbur had, 35 before you were accepted?
No. One.
One. Well, all right. Well, start reading his book and start copying.
Well,
plagiarism works sometimes. In fact, Wilbur, you said that sometimes it's very important to try to copy other people.
I think it's natural because life and the story of life is the same for nearly all of us. We are born, we live, and we die. And you've got to pick one and develop it. And so that my characters are usually a composite of 4 or 5 different people I know, or I think I know, and put it together in a convincing manner. That's what fiction is about.
Write that down. Right. How about on this side? It seems to be right. Yeah, okay. Yeah, the girl in a black shirt. Just speak.
So, just as a general question, do you ever feel that you have to compromise your original creative vision of a novel or a book with the practical procedures, say length of a book or like marketing strategies or editors' opinions, like how much do editors get a say in your vision of your book, that kind of thing.
Simon?
Yes, well, my answer will necessarily be different from Hannah's and Wilbur's because they write novels, except, of course, from Hannah's first. But as a non-fiction author, the book I'm working on at the moment, which is, it may sound a rather arcane topic, but I'm hoping to make it interesting, it's on the history of precision, which is something that exists like the oxygen in the air. It's all around us, and yet we don't really recognize it, and yet it's hugely important. To convince my editor, the proposal, which I wrote, and in a non-fiction, the non-fiction world, your proposal can be 20, 30 pages. That often, it doesn't so much get rejected as he looks at it, he's a chap called Henry Ferris in New York, and Arabella Pike in London, and they look at them between it and say, well, can we tweak it in such and such a direction and give it more of a narrative flow rather than be episodic and pointillist or whatever you might call it? And so the proposal goes through quite a lot of massage before it actually is accepted and a contract is signed, and that's how you write the book, which from my point of view is very satisfying because once I know that I am writing a book that they feel has a chance of being a commercial success, then it gives more sort of zip to my fingers, if you like.
It's because you believe in their professional.
Well, I do, and that's one of the important things, I think, that should be remembered when you decide whether to be self-published, like this lady is being tempted to do at the moment, and I think you should resist it, because editors and agents, but editors principally, are a very, very important component of the literary world. You, the author, of course, are the key, but it becomes a collaborative effort between you and the editor. And my relationship with Henry Ferris, my editor in New York, is very intimate and very important to me. And he can sculpt a book into something that changes from being, frankly, quite dull into something that one hopes is quite scintillating.
Hannah, you obviously, your first novel and so forth, let's say what happened to your approach to an agent or... and finding an editor, all that process, was that difficult or did you meet with a lot of resistance?
Well, when I first tried to get an editor many, many years ago and I got rejected by all of them, so and an agent, so the lady over there should take heart, and I gave up for a long time. With the last two books, which were published, they were, I think as Simon says, you can have a really, really good relationship with your editor who tends to be a kind of sounding board. So you write, it's almost like, you know, shouting into a cave and they're the echo that comes back. But I think, so yes, certainly with the first book, my editor was incredibly helpful in sculpting it and changing it and making it much, much better. With the second book, there was a tremendous fight. There's a painting in the book that talks. There's a painting who's a character. Sounds rather strange, but I think it works. I felt it worked for me. It was incredibly important. And the publishers wanted to get rid of my talking painting, and it was literally a kind of fight to the death, to the point where I said, no, you know, the book is not going to be published unless this stays in. So I think that there is a kind of negotiation, if you like. And you have to, there are some things you're going to fight for, and there are some things when you're going to have to concede. And it's like anything, it's a negotiation, I think.
You don't have very much resistance, do you? I mean, you just write it and people know that you will sell and they tend to shut up. Is that right?
Fortunately, that is what happens.
So it's all about money.
Oh, no, we don't think about money. My goodness gracious me.
Yes. All right.
I am in a different position to... my other two compatriots here, because I am writing my own thoughts and I am making up the story as I go along.
Yeah.
And so I've had enough, enough working with that.
Provenance.
Yeah, provenance, yeah. To be accepted.
Yeah. And yes, that's why people don't try to contradict you. It's like... you know, Henry Kissinger, something political, you don't say you're absolutely wrong, Henry. I mean, that would be very stupid to do, certainly in public. All right. Okay. Yes.
Hi there, thanks for the very interesting panel. I have a question, and I know this will push back a little bit. You initially said no stupid questions or only intelligent questions, and you cited the fact that the question of what inspires you is a stupid question, and I really would like to ask this question only because I'd like to challenge you on that, but also I think that what inspires the three different authors are very different, and I think there's something to be said about what inspires each author. So, you know, is it the money? Is it like a certain idea? Is it an experience? And what inspires you to write?
Well,
brave woman.
Let's have a try. What inspires you to write, Wilbur?
It certainly isn't the money. It's self-importance to tell a story and have other people read it and then to defend it.
Winchester?
I'd agree entirely with Wilbur. It's money has, I mean, obviously, I that's how I earn my living, so I hope that the book will sell. But it's you stumble across an idea or you dream up an idea, and you just get a passionate eagerness to write it. In my case, it would often be forgotten figures from history who you want to rehabilitate and bring to the public attention. And it is enormously satisfying when you...
Like Joseph Needham.
Well, like Joseph Needham, like William Smith, like W.C. Minor, like all of these weird characters.
James Murray.
James Murray, exactly. So I think that's what inspires me. Although the new book...
Don't make it too interesting. Hannah, what inspires you to write?
I think for me it's a form of I don't want to say navel gazing, but it's a way of exploring what you feel about the world and what you think about it and the things that really interest you. So to me it is literally the most exciting thing that I've ever done, and I'm so cross that I waited till I was very, very, very old to start.
You see, it's not very interesting, right? Yeah, the gentleman there was. Sort of funny haircut, yeah.
Thank you, sir. Well, like Simon, I wanted to travel the world, so I joined a company and published many books with the name Wilbur Smith on the cover, Transport Planning Consultancy. Right, the young lady next to me has written a book, like the lady over there. Stand up, Heather, show them. Her family say that she's going to starve to death, and she quite possibly will. It's the definitive Chinese novel, and it's quite long, 130,000 words in English. It's been rejected by 30 agents so far. She's now working on the second book. Okay, question back to the previous one. How, assuming we can find an agent at some stage for either the first book, she says the second one is better, but I haven't read it yet. Is it practical to work with an agent at a distance, because she's never getting a visa to go to UK or US. Is it practical to work with an agent in London while living in China? Thank you.
All right. I mean, is she sensible to write a second novel when her first has been rejected by 30 publishers or agents?
I think Mr. Smith also wrote his second novel while the first had been rejected, wasn't it?
I think that every case is peculiar and specific to the story, the writer, and the agent or the advisor. I would be reluctant to say that you must write through an agent. I refuse to take the advice of an agent until I'm asked. Until I ask, and then they give me the advice I need. But it's a very, very personal thing, a book. You put so much of yourself into it, of your own beliefs and your own... if you're a real good writer, you write from the heart. And if anyone challenges you, you are appalled that they are so stupid, that they can't see that you are a genius. And that is, I think, to have total self-confidence in yourself is essential for a writer.
What is your name? No, not yours. The girl, the one who written the book.
The pretty one.
That was rejected by 30 agents. What's your name? What was your name?
My name is Heather Tai.
Heather Tai.
Tai.
T-A-I.
C-A-I.
C-A-I, Chai, okay.
Yes.
All right, we'll remember that, just in case you become really famous.
Thank you.
We wish you well. We hope that you have become another J.K. Rowling. I mean, that's another example of, I mean, it is peculiar, but, I mean, it's not a necessary condition, nor a sufficient one for the...
Let me just interject for a second. My first editor, dead now, a chap called Charles Monteith in London, and he told me a story once of, he worked for Faber and Faber, and a lot of novels would come to him over the transom, in other words, not through an agent, and they would be read by sort of late middle-aged ladies, in this case she was called Maud, who would write a sort of one-sentence assessment whether it was worth reading or not. And he came back on a Friday evening from lunch to go off to where he lived in the Cotswolds, and there was on his desk a manuscript which had clearly done the rounds. It was covered with coffee mug and wine glass stains, and it was all bent and twisted, and there was a broken rubber band on it. And Maud, the lady at Faber and Faber, who had read it, said some rubbish about school children on a desert island, reject it. And for some reason, Charles put it in his briefcase and read it on the train going down to Cirencester and rang William Golding on Monday and said, I would like to publish The Lord of the Flies. So let that be an inspiration to you. And never, never, if I can just give you one piece of advice, never pay to have your work published. It's a temptation that people who are desperate and have been rejected by a lot of people, by a lot of agents, sometimes fall into the trap. If your book is worth publishing, someone somewhere, no matter how many rejections, you can wallpaper your bedroom with rejection slips, but sooner or later, if you persist, someone will publish it, and then it's up to the market.
I don't think she's going to pay anybody. Her father said that she's going to die of starvation.
Thank you.
She wants to get married and stop this silliness.
No, 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 don't stop the silliness.
Marry an agent. Hannah, what do you think? What advice would you give this slightly despondent girl who might yet become famous?
I agree with everything you said. Don't give up. Just keep going.
Don't give up.
Keep going.
As Churchill said, if you're in hell, keep going.
Thank you very much. I'd like to ask quite a personal question, because I have been wondering. One of the agents who actually published Harry Potter rejected me, who has already read my full book. And what they mentioned is about superstition, because in my book, I actually have written about something about superstition. So I'd like to know, out there, anyone who is in this area, particular area, about superstition? Or any book you have read about superstition?
Yes. Mick Jagger wrote a very good song, Superstition. Very successful.
Actually, I think it was Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder.
Yeah.
Sung by Mick Jagger. You see, you have erudition here. You can't get away with fluff. Okay. Back to this section. Question?
Satisfaction was Mick Jagger, I think. Yeah.
It's a book forum, not a record forum.
Record.
Who wrote Oh Well? Oh Well.
Oh Well?
Yes.
Oh.
Do you know who that was?
No.
That was...
No, to David.
Nor to you, that's what's...
not Fleetwood Mac.
Fleetwood Mac.
Sorry. Go on. Who would like to ask a question? Yes, the gentleman here with lots of hair, and then followed by you, yes. you with less hair.
Whenever I've heard Jeffrey Archer, he's always talking about how he works a certain time, certain months of the year. He does 2 hours in the morning, has a gap, 2 hours in the afternoon, has a gap, 2 hours in the evening. What's your particular technique for actually getting those words down on paper?
First of all, I wouldn't believe him, but there it is.
Well, no, and also Jeffrey Archer doesn't write his own books. They're all written by a man called Richard Cohen.
Oh, really?
Is that right?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have a very disciplined kind of writing regime?
No, I don't, but my wife has.
All right, okay. Yeah, that gentleman.
Okay, thank you. I think each of you had extraordinary career in writing, and you must have witnessed a lot of discussion about how the ecology of publishing industry has been changed in the past two decades with the rise of internet, and in particular social media. So I wonder, have any of you really feel the impact of the digital age in your profession? And do you think that the rise of a digital age changed the meaning of writing?
Well, Hannah, you're the
Thanks.
One who corrected me. Has the internet age changed writing, and what has it done to writing?
Well, lots of people say, don't they, that because we now read so much online in very, very short, truncated versions, that A, we won't have time, because surfing the internet's more interesting than reading books, and B, it's almost changed the way that we do read. Personally, though, I think that books will be around. I think people still have an incredible desire to escape into a book, into a well-told, long, well-crafted story. So I'm hoping that the death of reading, thanks to the internet, is you know, not any time soon.
And the figures confirm your hope. I mean, I live in America, and the book as a physical object is roaring back into popularity. Sales of digital e-books is plateaued and is now declining.
Why do you think that is?
Because I think what Hannah says is entirely true. I think people love, I don't want to go on about the usual thing about the tactile and all the physical pleasure of having a book. I think people don't like reading on screens. I think the big change came, oddly enough, with 50 Shades of Grey. Because people read that book and they were ashamed to be seen with it, so they could... for very good reason, I might say, having read it.
Read it.
I did read it, yeah.
So did I.
It's not very good. I just went to page 147, and there was not much in it, really.
What about Wilbur? Wilbur, did you read it?
Did you read 50 Shades of Grey?
I read the first 10 pages.
No, you've got to go to page 147. With your wife.
Well, no, please.
But now, internet, that's interesting, because you have now done something which is fascinating to me. After 45 years, you've changed publishers, and you've now gone over to HarperCollins, and you've persuaded them to publish a number of books very fast, so fast that you have agreed to have ghost or assistant writers. Now, tell us about why that has happened.
It's a secret thing.
Yes.
I have got to the stage where I have so many stories in my mind, and I wonder if we could put them down before something happens. And so I've chosen people who are successful writers on their own account, and I've found it a very moving and interesting experience to work with co-writers. And
because then they can produce more books more fast, so that you can cram everything in before something happens.
That's a very, very rude way of putting it.
But it's the truth. I mean, truth hurts.
Maybe.
Yes. All right. Well, that's fascinating. Okay. Anybody else? Yes. Man with white hair or none of at all.
Thank you. I think this question is perhaps more aimed at Mr. Winchester, who writes factual books rather than novels. mainly. I'd like to ask Mr. Winchester how he does his research, how and where he does his research, and what are the obstacles that he finds to digging out the facts that he needs for his books?
Well, the first thing I do when I mean, the precision book that I'm doing now, I first of all buy every imaginable book on the topic. So there's a bookstore in Vancouver that I use a lot, which has the most amazingly well-organized secondhand department. And I ring them up and they say, I'm going to do a book on precision, and they pull out all the sort of 19th century engineering tomes and, you know, the invention of the kilogram and things like that. And so I amass a pretty big library right from the beginning. And then I start identifying where I want to go. And for a book on precision, there's all the sort of old stuff. And so that's the Science Museum in London and various places in Britain where things were invented, and then Jefferson in Paris and various things that happened in France. But then I wanted to look at modern things that are very precise, and so I've chosen a number of things, a particular Rolls-Royce jet engine called the Trent XWB, the next generation of Hadron colliders in Geneva, a new generation of nuclear warheads that are being built. So I'm going to see them, and I'm going to Tokyo on Monday to go and see two companies there that make very, very precise measuring instruments. And so there's about a year of traveling and reading and meeting people and interviewing. And sometimes, you know, you reach a dead end and people are uncooperative or secretive. I mean, the people that are making the plutonium milling machines for this new generation of atomic weapons are necessarily rather secretive. They're in Livermore in California. But I'll sort of get to eventually, because having been a journalist, you get your teeth into these subjects and you don't tend to take no for an answer. And then, so I normally do about a year, maybe 15 months of research, and then sit down to write. And the deadline for this book is I've got to deliver the 130,000 words, oddly enough, the same length as that young lady back there, on the 30th of September next year. And so I'll begin the writing in March, I think, and deliver it on the 30th of September, I hope. So the book is divided essentially into three parts: the research, which is a year and a bit, the writing, which is about 9 months, and then the editing takes about 4 months, and the production, and then it comes out at an interval of roughly 2.5 years. Much longer, I think, than Wilbur. You crank them out much more rapidly, especially with your co-writers.
Yes, you do.
But Hannah, with your biography book, did you labour over a lot of research before you sat down and wrote the book?
Yes. Yeah. No. I had to research lots. I didn't know anything, for example, about jazz, so I had to do. And I still get letters from people now saying you got it wrong because Charlie Parker died on March 26th at 6 p.m., not at 6:15. Anyway, I still get endless corrections through the. Through the mail.
I mean, there are many examples in literature where authors write about places that they have not been to, places or people they don't know. I mean, not characters so much, but places they have not been to. And people sometimes get it absolutely right, and people sometimes get it absolutely wrong.
Was it H.R.F. Keating? Maybe I've got the name wrong, who wrote a series of novels about Inspector Goatee of the Bombay Police Force,
yes.
G-H-O-T-E.
Yes.
15 books about the machinations of the Bombay Police Force. He'd never been to India in his life.
Yes, but I suspect using the word Goatee, which of course
helps,
is
yes.
fish, helps.
Indeed it
helps. But also, yes. Isn't it, Madame Bovary, for example, I think Flaubert has her eyes 7 different colours. You know, this is one of the most famous books of all time. You know, yes. And it's sometimes they're light blue, sometimes they're dark blue, sometimes they're brown.
I mean, I saw a film last week called Tarzan. I mean, that was by Edgar Rice Burroughs. He's never been to Africa. He didn't even write Tarzan until
Tarzan
he was 36. and so that's extraordinary. And I think there are many other examples. I think
Shakespeare never went to Venice.
nor
Illyria, yeah,
probably. Nor France. Did he go to France? Probably didn't go.
I doubt
France.
It. Stratford.
Yeah, so yeah, Stratford.
Or Denmark.
Yeah, and Samuel Johnson wrote a novel about Abyssinia, and he'd never been to Abyssinia, although he got absolutely everything
Samuel
right.
Samuel Johnson wrote
you
a novel
even
about
more?
Abyssinia.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah,
It's called...
Yes, David. Another
Rezales.
The Blue Remembrance.
Rezales.
Hey.
So... Right, we've got 10 more minutes. Let's have a few more lively questions. It's getting... Well...
I can tell part two of the story.
Yes, you can tell part of that story in a minute. Okay, go on.
Simon, could you please continue with the stories?
I love you.
Are you related
to him?
Dying
to know.
Are you related to him? All right, okay, tell the second half of the story.
But it's going to take 5 or 6 minutes.
No, shorten it to 3.
I can't do it shorten it.
No, you can.
Okay, well, if you remember, it was James Morris. I wrote to him, can I be at you, blah, blah, blah. So I flew back to England. I couldn't get a job as a journalist for 6 months. I worked on an oil rig in the North Sea for 6 months, but eventually got a job in Newcastle upon Tyne, whereupon I wrote to James. By this time, I had read his books on Venice, on Spain, on Oxford, and realized he was a very significant writer. And I wrote to him and said, okay, I'm now a reporter in Newcastle upon Tyne. What next? And in his reply, you could sense the gulp of, you took my advice? That wasn't exactly what... And so I'll give you 3 further pieces of advice. One, never lose your sense of wonder, because you're going to meet extraordinary people and go to amazing places. So don't get world-weary and blasé. Don't bother to learn shorthand, complete waste of time. And every month, parcel up the stories you're writing for the paper in Newcastle. Send them to me. Here's my address in North Wales. And I will annotate them for you and hope to turn you into a halfway decent writer. And so I did that, and the months went past, and I left the Newcastle paper, and I went to The Guardian, and I went to Northern Ireland for 3 years, and then I was in Washington, every month writing to James, never meeting him, until 1974, when I was covering Watergate. Nixon resigned, then a week later Ford pardoned him, and the Watergate story was effectively dead in the water, and I decided to go on holiday and to go climbing, because I still climbed in those days, 1974. So I flew to London and met an Australian journalist on The Guardian called Jackie Leishman, and we drove up to North Wales to go climbing in Snowdonia. And on the way up on the M5 or the M6, she said, doesn't your friend James Morris live in Wales? And I said, yes, you're absolutely right, but I've never met him. And she said, this is ridiculous. You must ring him when we get to the hotel. So we got to the hotel. She found his number in the book, and I was terrified. I didn't want to speak to him, really. But she dialed the number and put the receiver to my ear. And this voice, I said, hello. And this voice said, hello. And I said, this is Simon Winchester, and this is James. I thought, I'm so proud of you. You're my protege. Are you ringing from Washington? I said, no, I'm in North Wales. Anyway, you must come for tea. So the agreement was that the following day we'd go for tea. So Jackie and I went climbing and came down from the hills at about 3 o'clock, went to this beautiful house in the village of Llanystumdwy, and parked the car and walked across to the front door, which I remember vividly had 2 panels of glass on either side, and you could see through it the parquet flooring and the carpets and things, and we were filthy dirty because we'd been up on the hills. So I rang the doorbell, and I said to Jackie, we better take our boots off. And the door opened when we were kneeling down, and a woman appeared. And I said, oh, hello, I'm Simon Winchester. This is Jackie Leishman. You must be Mrs. Morris. And this person said, oh, no, I'm James, actually. And I thought this was a little odd. So, but this was the 1970s, and people wore their hair rather long. So I said, oh, well, you can never tell these days. I'm awfully sorry. And this person then said, I'll get my wife. And I began to think, this is a peculiar, the Welsh are very peculiar people, a strange, rather unkind joke, because James had climbed Mount Everest to 26,000 feet. He had been a captain in the Brigade of Guards. He had had 4 children. He had walked alone across the Hadramaut. He was a very much of a man's man, I thought. So I thought whoever was coming down the stairs would be, in a big beard and a Yukon Jack's jumper or something, but not at all. Down the stairs comes this middle-aged English lady with a little girl in tow, and we all troop into the drawing room to have tea, with me, obviously, a chap, and my friend Jackie, a young woman, and then Elizabeth Morris, a middle-aged lady, and Suki, a 9-year-old girl, and my hero, James, wearing a twin set and pearls and a little hanky tucked up her sleeve and a slim, pencil-slim tweed skirt and legs decorously crossed and little court shoes and all the rather substantial accoutrements of womanhood. And But being Britain, of course, nothing was said about this. We just drank our tea, and Jackie, you know, we spent 2 hours there, and then Jackie and I left, and she's a forthright Australian woman, said, what was all that about? I had no idea. But then there was a letter pushed under my door in the hotel the next morning saying, dear Simon, I'm sorry to have put you through what must have been a rather awkward social ordeal, but the fact is that I'm becoming a woman. And I'm going to Casablanca next week to have the necessary surgery, and if it all works out, I'll be renamed Jan Morris, and I hope you can be accepted and be friends. Well, Jan and I are the best of friends. We've written a book together. She comes and stays every time she comes to New York.
She's written a very good book on Hong Kong.
A very wonderful book on Hong Kong, and we're the best. I would tempted yes. to say bosom friends, but and for years afterwards, the Guardian, any reporter that would-be reporter writing to the Guardian, how do I get a job on your paper? They'd say, it's very easy. You have to get a very bad degree in geology from Oxford and make good friends with a transsexual.
Transsexual or transgender? Transgender.
Well, I think back in 1974 it was transsexual.
Well, I had my hip replaced by a surgeon who was a man. It was called George. Then he changed into a woman, and he's called Sarah. And when I first met her, she had rather huge hands. And just before my operation, she told me that she had thought about changing back into a man. And I said that, can she first finish my operation before she does that? She did, in fact, the hips of both hips of the Queen Mother. But the left hip was done by as George, and the right hip was done by Sarah, yeah. And the Queen Mother was slightly puzzled apparently when on the second operation she saw this woman coming in to the theatre. Well, there it is, right. Okay, let's have some question for the panel. Come on. Yes, go on. The girl with the black hair and black blouse. Shirt, sorry.
Hello, and this following up the bravery of the girl on the left-hand side, and it's also a simple question. Reading and writing, obviously something extremely important for the writers on the stage. Can I ask how, in this world of advanced technology, text messaging, and also made-up words, how would you articulate the importance and also impact of ones may have received by proper writing and reading? I work for a British university, so therefore I'd like to see if there's any advice or how would you like to educate the millennials or the next generation about this? Thank you.
I'm not quite sure about. I understood that question, but does anybody understand?
We did.
Simon, you go first.
You're saying you ought to be brought back proper words and not made up words.
Yeah, we don't want to put LOL in our books and things like that.
Well, Prime Minister David Cameron didn't realise that it was lots of love or laugh out loud.
I absolutely think that. I mean, The books of mine that were initially successful were both about the Oxford English Dictionary. So I'm passionately keen on using words correctly, I suppose, and introducing words into the lexicon that perhaps have tempted to drift away. No, not overly clever use of words. It's funny.
You said the Watergate was dead in the water.
That was rather good, I thought.
Well, that's what I mean. I'm trying to.
But I got excoriated the other day by someone for using the word, and please, I don't mean to be offensive, but the word niggardly, meaning mean. It has absolutely nothing to do with any other connotation one might think. But someone wrote to me, and several people wrote to me and said, you could have chosen a better word. And my feeling was no. I wanted to resurrect.
Well, how about poor Agatha Christie from that word to an Indian, and an Indian to no one?
You mean 10 little Indians?
Yes, Indians, and then there was no one because they couldn't use the word Indian either.
These days, I know.
Yes, I mean my book I call it a chink in the armor, just to upset people who think that the chink word is derogatory, which is probably is, but I don't care really. I mean, do people really care? I don't think so. The word that you mention is used by the black people all the time.
But I'm not talking about... I'm talking about niggardly, David.
I know that. That's what... The point is that whoever wrote to you obviously was not well educated. Right. Of course I know niggardly. Yes, hello. Yes, very keen man with a... with golden-rimmed glasses.
Thank you. Mrs. Smith, your books are loved by all the readers all over the world, especially we Chinese in Hong Kong, in mainland China, in Taiwan. But the people in mainland China and Taiwan, they want to read your book in translated Chinese text. So as you know, your English novel cannot be translated word by word into Chinese, exactly every word you have written. So do you have any control of your translated text being available in Taiwan or in mainland China? I mean, in traditional characters or in simplified characters? Thank you.
Do you understand that?
I understand, but I don't speak any of those languages. So I have to rely on other people to come up
with. Well, do you think the translations are not good? Or is it because they are in... Well, it's just a bad translator. Well, you think the translations are literal and not good enough? No. I mean, obviously, in all translations, there will be give and take. I mean, I translated Charlie in a Chocolate Factory, and there's a word pun called the square that looked round. I mean, in the book, it was a cube, actually. It was a square, but he had eyes. It looked round. But, of course, the pun was the square that looked round. You know, there is no square that should look round. And I had to think of, for years, I mean, how to translate that. And I think that they're just bad and good translations. I mean, you should go and find a better... What he's saying is that you should find a better translator. So go and talk to your agent. Go and talk to HarperCollins.
It's the publisher who picks the translator.
Do people tell you that your books are badly translated?
No, the Japanese and the Germans write and say, what does this phrase mean so that I can translate it properly? They are so assiduous and so...
The German and the Japanese.
Yes, they're wonderful.
The two countries which lost the war.
It's funny though, isn't it?
You sold 24 million copies in Italy. You're a hot author in Italy. Can you explain that? Is it there's something about the Italian language that makes your novel...
I think a story
novel?
Is a story. Yeah. And if you render it properly, it's going to attract people of all languages, all sexes, all ages. And I think that is the answer to being a well-read, popular writer.
I just heard that they've just translated into Chinese Finnegan's Wake, which has taken somebody 10 years. I would have thought it should be much longer, but there it is. I wouldn't be able to understand it in either language, but there it is. All right, let's have one last question. Beautiful, wonderful, moving. Yes.
Okay, I have two questions, actually. One for Mr. Smith and then one general question. Because Mr. Smith, I've been reading you since 1985, and I love your books for two reasons in particular. One, because they're nearly all set in Africa, the continent of my parents. And number two, because of the political depth that you bring to, you know, many of your novels. But my question is, given the present political state of South Africa and Zimbabwe, you know, two of the places, you know, where your novels have been set, would there ever be another Courtney novel, for example, in present-day South Africa, or another Ballantine novel in what used to be Rhodesia, now to Zimbabwe? And then just to segue, the general question for the panel is, do political considerations ever influence what you write? Oh, and by the way, Simon, I defend your use of the word niggardly. N-I-G-G-A-R-D-L-Y, thank you very much.
I have lived through so many changes in Africa, and particularly in Southern Africa. It's been a fascinating time, but I would not like to pontificate on any aspects of it, except to say that Africa is African because it has, as its premier, people living in it, Africans. And so all my books have tried, from the very first one, When the Lion Feeds, to treat the African as his rightful place in African history. And I will continue to do that. If I see abuse by Africans of other Africans, I'm appalled by that. But it's fascinating to have lived in a country that has changed so radically over the years.
All right, Simon?
Well, in the most recent book that's come out, which is a big fat book about the Pacific Ocean, which...
By the way, let me advertise it for Simon, because he is so crafty. You know, nowadays, when you search a word in the internet, hundreds of things come up. And so he has contrived a title so long that it's got so many words, so any word you put in, his book will come out. It's called Pacific Silicon Chips and Surfboards, Coral Reefs and Atom Bombs, Brutal Dictators, Fading Empires, and the Coming Collision of the World's Superpowers. Very clever.
It's actually Pacific, the ocean of the future.
I know.
You are talking balderdash.
No, but that is...
That's the American edition.
Yeah, exactly, right. Yes. So I'm not... I'm telling the truth.
You totally are. And it's all to do with the American marketing people. Yes. Wanting, as you say, Google searches anyone that writes Brutal Dictators, the book. It's quite extraordinary. But I was just going to say that one of the chapters is all about the South China Sea and trying to get it right about, you know, who is the menace in the South China Sea. Is it China? Is it the US Navy? You tread a delicate path, and that's, I try to be fair, so... this is in no sense an anti-Chinese book, and I try and cover what's happening in the South China Sea, or the West Philippine Sea, as the Philippines call it, with some sensitivity. So it does play.
Good
into
luck.
Right.
Yep. All right.
Good luck, exactly.
Hannah, anything political that you might fear to tread on?
No, I'm lucky I live in Britain, which apart from our recent kind of peccadilloes is a reasonably... In fact, politics recently is so interesting, I'm not sure we're ever going to write about anything else. But until a couple of weeks ago, I'd say, you know, we're not very political. But now I think it'd be interesting to see how many books don't feature politics. Don't you?
Yes.
I mean, it's been much, much, much more interesting than anything I've read for a very long time, what's been happening.
Good. Well, I'm afraid the time is up, and I just want to thank our panel. I want you to join me in thanking Wilbur Smith, Simon Winchester, Hannah Rothschild, but I want us to thank you for coming. You're probably here today because it's so hot outside, and it's quite cool inside. So we're very pleased to have put this on a particularly hot day.
Thank you,
Thank you very much, our honorable speakers, and also Sir David Tang. Please give them a big hand again. And to thank for their participation at the Hong Kong Book Fair, we have prepared some small souvenirs for them.